three, two. I almost said, welcome to Monday Night Bible Study. That's what I always say in mine. Welcome to Monday Night Bible Study. You are now free to think. I never hear Mike say that, but I know he thinks that. That's what I always say. We kind of started as a little bit of a snarky joke in our Monday Night Bible Study. When I would say, you are now free to think. This goes into a long story in the environment we were in. You were not free to think. So anyway, I appreciate Mike really having the confidence in me to come over and stand in for him tonight. They're, you know, away. I think Louisiana, I think that's where they're going to visit relatives. So we talked about this a while back, and he wanted to have a review of some things, and we had talked about going over the five cycles of judgment for Israel, because you've noticed that he refers to it a lot, and it factors large in the things that we're going through in our study in Romans. This is a very important biblical concept, I guess we could say, for us to know and understand. And as we review this tonight, while there are many reasons to know and understand this, I'm going to talk about two very important reasons why we should know and understand about the five cycles of judgment for Israel. The first reason we'll talk about is actually here on the opening slide. It gives us a timeline, a sketch of Israel's entire history and prophetic program. It gives us, in a nutshell, God's plan for the nation of Israel, all in that one chapter there in Leviticus 26. If we understand the things in Leviticus 26 outlined in the five cycles of judgment, then we're going to understand the entire Old Testament. And a lot of the reasons why, for many of us, we may have spent years in church and even reading the Word, but we didn't really have a clear grasp on the Old Testament, is because we never learned Leviticus 26. And I'm going to tell you, that's the key to understanding it. So we're going to look at these things tonight. A lot to cover, so we'll move right along. This sheet has the basic scriptures we're going to use. I've got the scriptures in Leviticus on the PowerPoint. I don't have all of the scriptures on the PowerPoint because this is going to be kind of a Bible exercise. We're going to use our Bibles, and these other verses we look up, we're going to look them up in our Bible. One of the reasons for that is that while I love to use PowerPoint, and I use it all the time, I use it in my Bible study on Monday night, the downside to using a PowerPoint is that while you can read and understand the scriptures up here on the screen, you don't relate to them in here. And you'll be thinking, man, where was that verse he was talking about the other? Where was, you know? But if you look it up, then you know that's right back here in, you know, 1 Kings, 2 Kings, whatever. So we're going to have some kind of built-in Bible exercise tonight as we go through these things as well. So without further ado, we'll go into here. Reasons we talked about that, this review will focus on two of those reasons. The first one is because it's vitally important to understand this, because it establishes a framework for understanding the entire Old Testament. And this is the chart, the same one as that you've got in the handout. And it's probably a good thing, because this chart is really hard to read on the PowerPoint. Letters are kind of small and so forth. And you may have to excuse me. I may have to grab a cough drop every now and then. I get a little bit of dry throat. So here's a plug for our sponsor. That's the commercial for tonight. Hall's cough drops. Okay, the first cycle in Leviticus 26, 14 through 17. After God had told them about the way he was going to bless them, he had said, you know, I'll be your God, I'll be your protector, I'll provide for you. You'll have rain when you need it. Your fruit trees will be fruitful. Your crops will grow. You'll have all you need and more and so forth. Told him he would bless them. Now we come to the part where he says, but if ye will not hearken unto me and will not do all these commandments, and if ye shall despise my statutes, or if your soul abhor my judgments, so that ye will not do all my commandments, but that ye break my covenant, I also will do this unto you. I will even appoint over you terror, consumption, and the burning ague that shall consume the eyes and cause sorrow of heart. And ye shall sow your seed in vain, for your enemies shall eat it. And I will set my face against you, and ye shall be slain before your enemies. They that hate you shall reign over you, and ye shall flee when none pursueth you. So we find the first part of the cycles of judgment was a warning that he said, if you don't listen to me, don't listen to my word and keep my commandments, these are the things that are going to happen. Basically, diseases, blindness, and their crops would be stolen by their enemies. Let's go ahead and get started on our timeline here, because we're gonna need that. We'll just we can use brown for our timeline. Of course, we'll go ahead and start back here with Adam, and we've got the flood just to kind of give us perspective on the time, and then let's go ahead up here to. Abraham or Abram, and then from him came out the nation of Israel and went on. Let's see. Let me put my cross up here in a different color. Let's see if our red works. Looking kind of dry there. Yeah, it works okay. So we had Abraham, and then we had, let's just draw us a little kind of a, in your imagination, imagine a mountain. We'll call it, this is Mount Sinai. Is it A-I or I-A? It's A-I, right? Sinai, yeah. And this is where the Moses, let's put Moses up here, and the Ten Commandments and the other laws and so forth. And also while they were there, God made the Levitical covenant, the Mosaic covenant with them in Exodus 19, 5 and 6, where he said, I will make of you a kingdom of priests and a holy nation, a peculiar people, and so forth. That covenant was made, there at Sinai under Moses and so forth. So it was at that time when God was giving them all the laws and the Ten Commandments and all those things, giving Moses the instructions for the tabernacle and the priesthood and all of those things, that he told them this: if you keep all my commandments, then I'm going to bless you in these ways. If you don't, then these things are going to happen. He lined out to them these five divisions or cycles of judgment that were going to happen. So as they went on, and then we had Joshua and Judges. I'm going to have to write this kind of small. Cycle one started really not all that long after Moses' time. And it started in Judges chapter 2. Let's turn over there. And God had given them the warning, if you don't listen to me and you don't keep my commandments, this is what's going to happen. And it's important that we look at this and see what they did, what specifically they did. Joshua. Did I say Joshua? Judges chapter 2. Judges chapter 2. I always get Joshua and Judges mixed up. They're right there together, Be looking for something in one and look over there and I'm in the wrong book. Judges chapter 2. This was, I'll tell you what, let's read it. Let's start at verse 10. This is after Joshua died and so forth. Verse 10 says, and also all that generation were gathered unto their fathers, and there arose another generation after them, which knew not the Lord, nor yet the works which he had done for Israel. And the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord and served Baalim. And they forsook the Lord God of their fathers, which brought them out of the land of Egypt, and followed other gods of the gods of the people that were round about them, and bowed themselves unto them, and provoked the Lord to anger. Now, this is a key phrase that is very important in going through this study on the five cycles of judgment. Anytime you see, and that phrase occurs about four times through those cycles of judgment. Anytime you see that phrase, provoke the Lord to anger, that signals the beginning of the next cycle of judgment. So this signals the beginning of the first cycle of judgment. This is where it started. Because, and here's one of the most tragic things to me, back up here in verse 10, where it says, there arose another generation after them which knew not the Lord, nor yet the works which he had done for Israel. So what had they not done that they should have done? They hadn't been teaching their children. They didn't, you know, and that's the very reason that back over there in Deuteronomy somewhere, God had told them, look, when you're walking down the road, talk about me and what I've done and talk about my word. When you're sitting in the house, talk about my word. When you're, you know, by the way, or write them on the posts of your gate and write them on the doorposts of your house and all those kind of things so that this very thing wouldn't happen. But because they neglected to do that, and there's some other things they're neglecting to do too that we'll talk about when we get to the fifth cycle. But because they neglected to do that one very thing, teach their children, this generation grew up. They didn't know anything about God. They didn't know anything about his word. Didn't know anything about this, these warnings that God had given them. And so, lo and behold, and because they hadn't driven out all of those pagan tribes of people all around them, they adopted their pagan ways and began to worship their pagan gods and so forth and provoked the Lord to anger. So, our first cycle of judgment starts right there at Judges chapter 2 is where that begins. And that goes through 1 Samuel 15:35. You got that all. I don't really have to write all this up here, but I am because it helps me keep it all straight. Now, through 1 Samuel 15:35. Now, there were some things happening during that cycle one that caused Israel to be liable for, or eligible for, I guess you could say, guilty of the things that would cause the second cycle of judgment to happen. And we'll look at those in a second. Let's go ahead and look at the second cycle and the warning that comes there. In verse 18, Leviticus 26, he says, after he had done these things, and actually, if you're still in Judges 2, let's go back there. I wasn't finished reading yet. Verse 14, I needed to read that. Says they forsook the Lord and served Baal Asheroth. The anger of the Lord was hot against Israel, and he delivered them into the hands of spoilers that spoiled them, and he sold them into the hands of their enemies round about, so that they could not any longer stand before their enemies. Aha! What had God said? What did he say he was going to do? I'll set my face against you, and you shall be slain before your enemies. They that hate you shall reign over you, and flee when none pursueth you, and ye shall sow your seed in vain, for your enemies shall eat it. And so here we find down here, he delivered them into the hands of spoilers that spoiled them, into the hand of their enemies round about, and so forth. So those exact things that God said he was going to do, he did. He let those things happen. Now, remember that when they came into the land, it was a very fruitful land. The crops grew. There were fruit trees. They had rain when they needed it. All of their fields and their fruit and everything was very productive. Their animals were productive and all that. That didn't stop. That continued as a reminder to them of what God had said. He said, I'll be your provider. I'll make your fruit trees fruitful and your fields productive and all your animals reproduce and all that stuff. That continued to happen. But their enemies came in and stole it. You remember during, you can read through Judges, you know, all those stories about Samson and fighting the Philistines and the Midianites that came in, and, you know, Gideon was hidden in the wine vat and he was thrashing grain in there because he didn't want the Midianites to steal the what little grain he had, and all those kind of things. All those raids by the Philistines and the Midianites and all that. That's specifically what they did, and that's who did it, and that's why. God had told them this would happen, and sure enough, it happened. Okay, cycle two warning. Because they didn't listen during this time, and they didn't repent, and they didn't turn back to God, this is the warning that he said was going to happen. If ye will not yet for all this hearken unto me, then I will punish you seven times more for your sins. And I will break the pride of your power, and I will make your heaven as iron and your earth as brass, and your strength shall be spent in vain. For your land shall not yield her increase, neither shall the trees of the land yield their fruits. Did any of you grow up over in the Black Land? That's where we live, over in the Black Land. Well, if you didn't, or I would say if you did, then you could relate to this. Your earth as brass, because I'm going to tell you what, sometimes that black dirt is as hard, it's like you're trying to plow brick. So it's either wet and muddy and sticky, or it's too dry to plow. But this is what he said: if you still don't listen to me, in addition to your enemy stealing your crops and diseases and blindness and things like that, I'm going to add this. I'm going to break the pride of your power, and there's going to be drought. The heaven is going to be like iron. There will be no rain, and your ground is going to be like brass. It will be hard, and you no longer will have good crops and fruit trees and all those kind of things. And your strength will be spent in vain. Your land won't yield its increase and those kind of things. This is the warning. That's what was going to happen. Now, right there, when cycle one ended, cycle two didn't begin right off, because I used to have a class of about fourth through sixth graders, and it would drive them absolutely nuts if I ever did that. If I opened a pen and a marker and set it in there without putting the cap on there, you could just see it. They just couldn't stand it. You know, hey, you didn't put the cap back on there. They had probably been yelled at for not putting the cap back on there. But something happened here, and just to save room, I'm gonna just draw it down here. I'm going to call it we'll just initial it IOM. You could say an interlude of mercy. I think that's what Mike calls it. An intermission of mercy during the lives of David and Solomon. Is that in 1 Samuel 16, that's where we see David begin to come in. Samuel goes and anoints him as king and so forth. Saul in 1 Samuel 15, that's the chapter where Saul finally messes up so bad that he angers God, and God says, okay, Saul is out. Sorry that I made him king and he's out. He tells Samuel, go anoint David, and David comes in, and this begins his reign. So there's a period of time here of about 80 years or so during the reigns of Solomon, of David and Solomon, where in spite of the fact that they had done some things during cycle one that made them eligible for cycle two to begin, God kind of like he did when he paused Israel's program and brought in the dispensation of grace. He didn't bring in the second cycle immediately. He gave them a chance. He extended mercy to Israel and showed them what the kingdom could be like under righteous rule. Because David, we know all of the David's mess ups and all that kind of stuff. Yeah, but here's the thing. David loved the Lord, man. He never turned from God. We know he did some dumb things, but he never turned from the Lord. He never worshiped idols. He loved the Lord all of his life. Now, Solomon, on the other hand, he had a pretty good start But he went off the deep end like, you know, just about nobody, I guess, ever has. He's, you know, a unique character in the Bible. And I know it's easy for us to look back over time and think, man, how could he have been so stupid? Well, who knows? We're in the same position. We might have done the same thing. I'm sure, you know, people could look at me and say the same thing about some of the dumb things I've done. How could he have been so stupid? Nevertheless, there was a time of mercy when Israel had the opportunity to see what it could have been like under righteous rule had they just simply listened to the Lord and done what he said. All right. Cycle two, there's the warning. Let's turn over to 1 Samuel 2, and we're going to look at the things that they did that caused the second cycle to happen. 2 Samuel 2, and I'm following the scriptures on this sheet that I gave you. One of the reasons I wanted to give you all of these things, and most of them have the same information, they're just in a little different formats, is you can keep these for study guides. And if you ever have an opportunity to talk to somebody about this, you'll kind of have something that you can make a copy of it and give it to them, or you might be able to, you know, help you go down through here and show somebody these things. Very interesting things. It's very important for us to know. 2 Samuel chapter 2. Look at verse 12. It says, now the sons of Eli were sons of Belial, and they knew not the Lord. And the priest's custom with the people was that when any man offered sacrifice, the priest's servant came while the flesh was in seething with a flesh hook of three teeth in his hand. Let's skip down to verse 17. Wherefore I'm doing this to kind of save time. I'm going to run out of time. Wherefore the sin of the young men was very great before the Lord, for men abhorred the offering of the Lord. Now, jump down to verse 22. Says, now Eli was very old and heard all that his sons did unto all Israel and how they lay with the women that assembled at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. So these, his sons who were in charge of the tabernacle, they were sons of Belial, which means they didn't know the Lord and care anything about God. They were just filling a religious position and ripping the people off and taking advantage of the women who came to pray or, you know, whatever they came there for. So they were bad men. Anybody other than me glad that the Pope's finally gone home? Anyway. So that's one of the things they did. Now, let's turn. I just happened to think of that for some reason, not sure why. Let's turn over to chapter 8. Chapter 8, 1 Samuel. We're still in 1 Samuel, chapter 8, and verse 1. It says, and it came to pass when Samuel was old that he made his sons judges over Israel. Now the name of the firstborn was Joel, and the name of his second, Abiah. They were judges in Beersheba. And his sons walked not in his ways, but turned aside after lucre and took bribes and perverted judgment. Then all the elders of Israel gathered themselves together and came to Samuel unto Ramah and said unto him, behold, thou art old, and thy sons walk not in thy ways. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations. But the thing displeased Samuel when they said, give us a king to judge us, and Samuel prayed unto the Lord. So here's the things they did. There were sons of Belial in charge of the tabernacle of God. They were ripping the people off, taking advantage of the women, and so forth. Then Samuel's sons kind of did the same thing. He put them in charge, and they were greedy after money, and they were taking bribes, and they were perverting judgment and all these kind of things. And because of that, the elders of Israel came to Samuel and said, okay, this is not working. This system that God set up, we don't want this anymore. We want a king like all the people all around us. And one of the things back there God had warned them about was that I don't want you to be like all the nations around you. I don't want you to have a king like them, and I don't want you to follow their ways and follow their customs and their laws and so forth. So what they're doing here is, you know, turning against God and they're rejecting Him. So these are the things that make them eligible for the second cycle of judgment to start. Now let's look at the trigger. Turn over to 1 Kings chapter 11. And this will be the thing that got it started off and kind of catalyzed it. 1 Kings 11, verse 1 says, "But King Solomon loved many strange women, together with the daughter of Pharaoh, women of the Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Zidonians, and Hittites, of the nations concerning which the Lord said unto the children of Israel, Ye shall not go into them, neither shall they come in unto you, for surely they will turn away your heart after other gods. Solomon clave unto these in love. And he had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines, and his wives turned away his heart. For it came to pass, when Solomon was old, that his wives turned away his heart after other gods, and his heart was not perfect with the Lord his God, as was the heart of David his father. For Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Zidonians, and after Milcom, the abomination of the Ammonites. And Solomon did evil in the sight of the Lord, and went not fully after the Lord, as did David his father. Then did Solomon build an high place for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab, in the hill that is before Jerusalem, and for Molech, the abomination of the children of Ammon. And likewise did he for all his strange wives, which burnt incense and sacrificed unto their gods." So here we find Solomon, of all people, turning from the Lord, who had appeared unto him two times. Now, I would think that if God had appeared to you one time, that would be a tremendous life-changing event that you would never, you know, you wouldn't forget about that and be the same, and never be the same. But anyway, we could spend a lot of time on that. We're not, just wanted to read it, and we'll move on. That's what happened that started the second cycle of judgment, what Solomon had did. And so that ended the interlude of mercy, and that brought in cycle two. First Kings 12 is when that began. Okay, in this cycle, here's what's going to happen. He's going to break the pride of their power. They'll have drought, and their crops will fail, and so forth. This would take the form of, let's turn to, let's see. Well, we're here at 1 Kings 12. Good, that's where we need to be. We'll look at verse 27. What's going to happen is, at this point, this is where the kingdom is divided. After Solomon dies, he has his son Rehoboam, and then there's Jeroboam that is another son and kind of heir. And so it ends up with Jeroboam, the leader of the 10 tribes of Israel in the north, and Rehoboam is the leader of Judah and Benjamin over Jerusalem in the south. Rehoboam was the one where, you remember the story there, where he didn't take the advice of the elders that told him, you know, take it easy on the people, lessen the tax burden and so forth. No, he took the advice of his young, you know, friends, and they said, your father whipped him with whips, you should whip him with scorpion tails and something like that. So that's what he did, and it caused a civil war. So it broke the pride of their power. That's what happened. It divided Israel, and they were never a unified, you know, they were a powerful nation under David and Solomon. During that 80-year period, that was a really major transition there in the whole, you know, Levant, Canaan area. They had a tremendous impact there and became wealthy and powerful. I mean, during that time, Solomon was the most wealthy king anywhere in that, you know, area of the world during that time. So, the nation was divided, and they wound up in drought. Where are we? Verse 20, 1 Kings 12, 27. If this people go up to, this is Jeroboam speaking here, and this is what happens to what he did during the second cycle that caused the beginning of the third cycle. Here's what he did. If this people go up to do sacrifice in the house of the Lord at Jerusalem, then shall the heart of this people turn again unto their Lord, even unto Rehoboam, king of Judah, and they shall kill me and go again to Rehoboam, king of Judah. Whereupon the king took counsel and made two calves of gold and said unto them, it is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. Behold thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. And he set one in Bethel, and the other put he in Dan. This thing became a sin. For the people went to worship before the one, even unto Dan, and so forth. So this is what Jeroboam did. He made two golden calves, and they weren't huge, like big life-size calves. They were probably about that big, because that's about the size, normal average size of these bull idol images that you see that they excavate over there from Canaanite times. So it's probably about that big. And he set one in Dan, one in Bethel. And the worst thing that he did, he attributed the power and the glory and the majesty of Almighty God to these idols. He said, these are the gods that led you out of Egypt and all those kind of things. So he did something in that act that was so bad that stuck with Israel and kind of set a precedent for them that none of those evil kings of Israel ever broke away from all the way through. And we're not going to take the time to read all the verses because we don't have time to go through all of those details tonight. But if you read through this, you'll see where, you know, the next king it talks about that was evil and did evil in the sight of the Lord, and he didn't part from the sins of Jerry, walked in the sins of Jeroboam, which made Israel to sin with these two calves and things like that. So this is the thing that he did that provoked the Lord to anger and caused the them to be eligible for the third cycle. Now there's another thing, 1 Kings 22. Let's look over here right quick. I'll tell you what, let me go ahead and we'll go ahead and look at this because we're moving into the third cycle. We'll go ahead and look at this, but go ahead and turn to 1 Kings 22 because we're going to read there next. But let's go ahead and read this in Leviticus 26 here about the third cycle. Now, he had told them at the first, if you won't listen to me and follow my commands, these things are going to happen. Second cycle warning, he said, if after all this you still won't listen to me and still won't keep my commands, these things are going to happen. Now, in the third cycle warning, it says this, and if you walk contrary unto me and will not hearken unto me, I will bring seven times more plagues upon you according to your sins. I will also send wild beasts among you which shall rob you of your children and destroy your cattle and make you few in number, and your highways shall be desolate. Let's put a definition up here. Let me just write it right here. All right. To walk contrary means to treat God as though he is not their God. This would be like, you know, wives treating your husband like he's not. You might want to do that sometime. I don't know that guy, but or your husband treating your wife as though, you know, she's not your wife. I don't know you. I never met you. You're nothing to me. That's what they were doing to God after the covenants that he had made with them and all of the, you know, blessings that he had given them, taking them into the land and all that. So here's what they began to do. Walking contrary to God, treating him as though he was not their God. And here's the specific thing that this king of Israel did that was walking contrary to God. 1 Kings 22. Let's see. Let's look at verse 51. Ahaziah, the son of Ahab, began to reign over Israel and Samaria the 17th year of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, and reigned 2 years over Israel. And he did evil in the sight of the Lord and walked in the way of his father and in the way of his mother. and in the way of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who made Israel to sin. For he served Baal and worshipped him and provoked to anger the Lord God of Israel. See, there's that phrase again, and we're seeing he's, because of what he did, third cycle is about to begin. Provoked to anger the Lord God of Israel according to all that his father had done. Now, let's jump right over into 2 Kings and chapter 1. Look at verse 2. It says, and Ahaziah fell down through a lattice in his upper chamber that was in Samaria and was sick. And he sent messengers and said unto them, go inquire of Baal-zebub, the god of Ekron, whether I shall recover of this disease. So instead of, I mean, this was the king of Israel. He had the, you know, the temple, had the priests and all those kind of things. But when he fell down through the roof and was hurt and wanted to know if he was going to survive it or not, he sent his servants. He said, go down there to Ekron, which is one of the chief five cities of the Philistines, and go down there. And this, from what I understand, the Philistine god of Ekron, some form of Baal or some deity they had there, operated similar to like the Greek oracles. You could go there, and especially if you paid money, you know, you could get some kind of revelation or something like that, divination and so on. So instead of asking the Lord God if he was going to survive this, no, he said go down there and seek out the counsel and the divination of a pagan god. So this specifically he did in treating the Lord God as though he was not his God. So this is the thing that specifically this king of Israel did that constituted walking contrary to God. Cycle two, we remember, you know, they had the division of the kingdom and the drought. We remember, let me just go ahead and put Elijah was the prophet of the second cycle. Now then, cycle three is about to begin. And let me just go ahead and put his name up there because we're going to look at him right away. Elisha. Now, let's go over to, let's see, we're in 2 Kings. Look right here in chapter 2. Over in verse 23. Now, this is after, and I know we're skipping a lot of details of a lot of stuff, but in between there, this is when Elijah and Elisha went out there, and they went down through the plain of Jordan, crossed the river, and Elijah was taken up in the whirlwind. His mantle fell and fell on Elisha, and so Elisha came back across the river in the, you know, in the power. He was now the prophet representing God to Israel and so forth. And so as he made his way back up into the mountains there, we'll find out an interesting thing that happened. 2 Kings 2 in verse 23 says, and he went up from thence unto Bethel, and as he was going up by the way, there came forth little children out of the city and mocked him and said unto him, go up, thou bald head, go up, thou bald head. And he turned back and looked on them and cursed them in the name of the Lord. And there came forth two she-bears out of the wood and tare 42 children of them. And he went thence to Mount Carmel and so forth. So here we find an interesting incident. Now, if you're like me, read this story all my life, heard about it all my life. You'd always have some, especially bald preachers, they'd always read this and, you know, kind of half jokingly about it. See what's going to happen if you make fun of bald preachers and blah, blah, blah. I know Mike would make that joke if he was here. If you're like me, you read this, you thought, something about that just doesn't really, doesn't that seem a little bit harsh, you know? And you're thinking, why in the world would that happen? Well, if you don't know anything about the cycles of judgment, then you're not going to understand. There's a very specific reason why this happened. God had warned them that if they didn't listen to him, didn't heed the warning, still didn't listen to him, and they began to walk contrary to them. These things are going to happen. I will also send wild beasts among you, which shall rob you of your children, destroy your cattle, and these other things. You can bet we have this incident's details of where these bears came out of the woods and mauled these 42 kids. And I know it says little children here, but it says that because they were not, you know, they were like under a certain age, like legal age. These weren't two-year-olds running out in the road, you know, making fun of the stranger that's coming through town. These were kids that were old enough to know what was going on. And there's a lot in what they said. When they said, go up, thou bald head, go up, they were sending a message to Elisha that they didn't want him there. They knew who he was. They knew he was the prophet of God. They knew he had the mantle and the power of Elijah. They knew who Elijah was. Listen, from Bethel, you stand up there in those hills, and you can look down there. You can see the whole Jordan Valley. You can see Jericho over there, and you can see that river crossing where they would have crossed. So this is not a huge, big area. Those people that lived around there knew what was going on. They knew who Elijah and Elisha were and so forth. I mean, everybody knew who Elijah was with all the things he had done. And so as Elisha came back up, and listen, the reason that this happened to them and they're mocking about going up was because they didn't want him there anymore than they wanted Elisha around there. They were walking contrary to God. They didn't want anything to do with the prophets of God. And also, the reason that Elisha here was bald was because he had shaved his head in mourning. That was the custom. That's what they did. And in mourning over losing his mentor, and not just that, but he understood these judgments that were coming on Israel, and he knew what was going to happen. He understood these things. Of course, being a prophet, he not only knew the word, he had revelation of these things too. So the fact that he was bald was deliberately. He had shaved his head and was in mourning over these things. So when these kids came out there, they knew that. And they were mocking him because he was the prophet of God and also because he was in mourning. And because of that, this cycle of judgment, like flipping a switch, bang, out of the woods came these bears and mauled 42 of these kids. So, note, and the thing is, if that were to happen instantly, within a very short period of time, word spread. I guarantee you, back in those ancient times, news spread almost as fast as it does these days. You know, I mean, we got phones, and we can keep up with what's going on in the all worldwide, you know, instantly. Well, they could just about do the same thing back then. They knew what was going on. So, well, when this happened, I mean, everybody heard this story of what had happened up there. And other stories began to come in. Well, yeah, there was a caravan going down the road between these cities, and all of a sudden, wolves, bears, lions, whatever, came out and just mauled the whole bunch. And these instances like this began to happen so much that travel was dangerous. And their numbers, actually, population numbers of areas began to actually be reduced because of the attacks of these wild animals. And it was trying to get their attention. And listen, during these parts, they still had plenty of opportunity to repent and turn back to the Lord. They were going to reach a point of no return, but they hadn't got there yet. So, all right, let's look at the fourth cycle, and we're going to hit that just about on the, according to the timer here, about on time. So that's good. I was concerned about that. Fourth cycle warning. God says, and if ye will not be reformed by me, by these things, but will walk contrary to me, then will I also walk contrary unto you, and will punish you yet seven times for your sins. So back here, when they began to treat God as though he's not their God, then God says, okay, if that's the way you're going to act toward me, if that's going to be our relationship, that you're going to treat me as though you don't know me, then I'm going to flip that back around and I'm going to respond to you and I'm going to treat you as though you're not my people. So they're going to begin to be set aside as that nation. Now, this doesn't mean that God is breaking his covenant. He's faithful to keep his part. It's Israel that is not keeping their part. Well, let's finish reading this. I will bring a sword upon you that shall avenge the quarrel of my covenant. This is specifically talking about the Levitical covenant in Exodus 19, where he says, I'll make of you a holy nation, a peculiar people, and kingdom of priests, and so forth. And when you're gathered together within your cities, I will send the pestilence among you, and ye shall be delivered into the hand of the enemy. And when I have broken the staff of your bread, 10 women shall bake your bread in one oven, and they shall deliver you your bread again by weight, and ye shall eat and not be satisfied. So here's what we see, and if we, like I say, or you could go in there and you could read through these, between these scripture reference verses as we have, and you'd see this was in a time when Israel began to come under siege by their enemies. There was Hazael in, I think, the 9th century, I believe it was, B.C., and then there was Sennacherib in the 8th century and so forth. It came and laid siege to all those cities in the Levant and wiped out many of those cities and took them captives and so forth during Hezekiah and a lot of those kings and so forth. So we see this happen as they begin to come under siege by their enemies. Their food ran short. They had to ration. That's what it means that they had 10 women had baked their bread in one oven. They should deliver you your bread by weight. It'd be rationed out. You'd eat and not be satisfied. Barely enough to keep them alive, and that was about it. Okay, let's look at the things that they did to cause the fourth cycle to begin. Let's see. We're in 2 Kings. Look in chapter 3. Verse 1. Now Jehoram the son of Ahab began to reign over Israel and Samaria the 18th year of Jehoshaphat king of Judah and reigned 12 years. And he wrought evil in the sight of the Lord, but not like his father and like his mother, for he put away the image of Baal that his father had made. Nevertheless, he cleaved unto the sins of Jeroboam the son of Nebat, which made Israel to sin. He departed not therefrom. That was in making those two calves that Jeroboam set up and said, here's your God, Israel, that delivered you out of Egypt and so forth. He continued in that. Let's see, where did I depart not therefrom? That's where I was going to stop right there. So that's one of the things that happened to cause the fourth cycle to begin. Let's see, and then turn over here to chapter 10, 2 Kings 10. Second Kings 10, verse 29. And this goes on through, you know, several of the kings during this period of time, talking about Jehu. Howbeit from the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who made Israel to sin, Jehu departed not from after them, to wit, the golden calves that were in Bethel and that were in Dan. And let's see. Let me go ahead and read a couple of verses here. Yeah, we need to read on down. The Lord said unto Jehu, because thou hast done well in executing that which is right in mine eyes, and hast done unto the house of Ahab according to all that was in mine heart, thy children of the fourth generation shall sit on the throne of Israel. But Jehu took no heed to walk in the law of the Lord God of Israel with all his heart, for he departed not from the sins of Jeroboam, which made Israel to sin. In those days the Lord began to cut Israel short, and Hazael smote them in all the coasts of Israel. Hazael was the king of Damascus at that time. He came down with a huge force and invaded the Levant and took over several cities down there. Hazael smote them in all the coasts of Israel and from Jordan eastward and so forth. Names a lot of the lands here and so forth. So the same thing. walking contrary to God, continually attributing God's power and majesty to these golden calves, and they never departed from that. Interesting thing about King Hazael of Damascus. In the archaeological excavations at Tel Asafi, which is Gath, the ancient, you know, city of Gath, Goliath's hometown. You stand on top of that tell, and it's very high, chalky white limestone hill that this city, large city, was built on. If you stand on top there, on the hill, there's a kind of a shallow valley below that goes up to low hills on the other side. And you can see a dark line all the way around that city. Starts at the river over here, or not the river, they call it the Elah River. It's dry now, flowed then. Line goes all the way around in the ground, all the way around back to the river over here. And that is a siege trench that was dug by the troops of Hazael back there when he laid siege to Gath. And they've excavated things in there. And it's interesting that it's still there. You can see it today. So a lot of these things that archaeology shows us and verifies the historicity of the Bible. So it's very important, the archaeological work that's done. And more things all the time are being excavated and discovered that verify the historical facts of the Bible. So it's interesting and very, very important, but it's there. So these are the things they did. This began the fourth cycle of judgment. They were under siege in their cities. They began to have to ration their food. Many of their cities fell. During this time, this kind of began the decline of the northern 10 tribes of Israel. And they actually went into captivity under Assyria about 175 years, I think, maybe a little longer, before Judah and Benjamin did. Let me go, I guess I need to, since we're in fourth cycle, let me go ahead and put that up there. So, during this time, they were walking contrary to God. He's beginning to walk contrary to them. Now, they keep on in that, and up to this point, they still have the opportunity to repent and avoid the even worse conditions that are coming up when the fifth cycle begins. So we're almost out of time, so I'm gonna stop right there and not go into the fifth cycle yet. And that way, that'll give us time in the second hour or second division of the class to spend some time on the fifth cycle, which is important because there are some very important prophetic things we can look at in there. And that will segue into point number two of why it is very important to understand these cycles of judgment in Leviticus 26. So I guess we'll take a break. Anybody have a question or comment on any of this?
Is there any way to label these cycles as far as saying on cycle one, this is when we think of it in our heads to say,
yeah,
this is what happened. Cycle two, I could call cycle two this.
Take that chart. If you've got one of these charts, I've got just the like the basics in here of you know, up here the warning in Leviticus, and then what the warning basically says, then the resulting judgment says, you know, like diseases, blindness, and so forth, and then the corresponding time period down below that. So you didn't get one of those? Okay, I'll make sure you get one. But the basic facts about the cycles of judgment are on this chart right here. So if you, you know, kept that where you could get to it or put it in your Bible or something, if you had that, you could, you know, refer back to that. And one of the things that is important about learning this is that when you're reading in the Old Testament somewhere, or you're listening to somebody else read or teach or preach out of the Old Testament, if they're in, you know, between 1 Kings 12 and 1 Kings 22, then you're going to know that's the second cycle of judgment. And the things that they're talking about or that you're reading about that are happening, you're going to know why those things happened, where that came from, and tie it all in. So this gives you a reference point so that no matter where you are in the Old Testament there, you'll know why the things are happening that are and what they tie into and how they relate to the cycles of judgment. And there, another thing, too, that if you're looking at any of this, correlating this to the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, as you read through them, by understanding this, you're going to see things in there where Jesus, during his ministry, begins to do things that counteracts the punishments that are found in the cycles of judgment. Because like in cycle one, where God says that they're going to, you know, have diseases and blindness and things like that. Well, a lot of what Jesus did, he healed a lot of blind people. He healed a lot of diseases. Also, when he fed the people on the mountainside with the loaves and the fishes and things like that, there are reasons why he did those things. None of that was arbitrary. And what he was doing, he was showing, see, those things Jesus did and healing and doing those miracles and feeding people miraculously, he was showing them that he had the authority to go back and counteract what Israel had done. Because he was bringing them mercy and he was their Savior. And so all those things he did, it ties back to this. And reason why he did a lot of those things. So that adds to our understanding. Say, go ahead.
Are you going to be the fourth part in the fifth cycle?
Yeah. Okay. What do we got? We got one, two, three, and four. Yeah. We'll start on the fifth cycle next. And now, let me give you a disclaimer. You may notice that in some of my notes, I've got the fifth cycle in only four parts. Mike divides it into five parts. Both viewpoints are right, and I'll explain it when we get into it. It's just kind of a, he adds one division in there that I don't, and I'll explain that. It's kind of one of those things that either viewpoint really is correct. It's just in how you want to look at it. Besides that, I didn't want to have to go back and change all my charts. I did these a good while back when we went through this with our Bible study Monday night.
He found that other division that he thinks.
Yeah, and yeah, like I say, it's one of those things. Either way you want to look at it is fine. So anyway, let's take a break and we'll.